Welcome back, World History. Today we're going to talk about Battle of Britain and the beginning of the Holocaust. Quick reminder about where we've been. So in 1938, Germany begins to rearm the Rhineland, which is this area right in here, this area that according to the Treaty of Versailles was supposed to be free of arms. So 1938, Hitler begins a series of aggressive moves, including the rearming of the Rhineland. In addition to, he takes this area of Czechoslovakia called the Sudetenland, and he also performs something called the Anschluss, the reunification with Austria. So he takes all of this territory. He does the same sort of propaganda move by saying that in each of these territories that Germans are being mistreated and that it's his duty to go and protect them. By 1939, because no one had done anything about the fact that he'd taken these territories aggressively, and Neville Chamberlain, who was leading Great Britain at the time, had appeased him by saying, well, we'll give you these if you just don't take any more. And that empowered Hitler to then go ahead, sign a non-aggression pact with the Soviet Union, and head into Poland and take half of it. Initially, they kept the Soviet Union out of the war by promising them this territory here, half of Poland. Soviet Union went ahead and took this area up in here to regain some of the lost territory from the Treaty of Versailles, which stripped them of a lot. By this time, the French and the British are fully expecting the Germans to turn and move in the same direction that they moved in World War I, but instead, Hitler surprisingly moves to the north. So he heads to Norway, and this is pretty strategic geopolitically, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. And only then does he decide to head into France. He's very effective. He uses a new type of military strategy called the Blitzkrieg or Lightning War, and quickly topples France and replaces sends Charles de Gaulle running to Great Britain, where he sets up a government in exile and leaves the Vichy government, headed by a guy named Pétain, in France, kind of as a puppet government. Okay, and this is where we're going to pick up today, because this is where we left off with France fallen, and now he's trying to figure out what to do with Great Britain. So with the fall of France, Great Britain stood alone against the Nazis. Winston Churchill, who you see here on the bottom left, the new British Prime Minister who had replaced Neville Chamberlain, had already declared that his nation would never give in. In a rousing and very famous speech, he proclaimed, "We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall never surrender." So Hitler now turned his mind to an invasion of Great Britain. His plan was to first knock out the Royal Air Force and then land more than 250,000 soldiers on England's shore across the English Channel. In the summer of 1940, the Luftwaffe, which is the German Air Force, began bombing Great Britain. At first, the Germans targeted British airfields and aircraft factories, but then on September 7th of 1940, they began focusing on cities, especially London. The strategy was to break the British morale, to break the British citizenry. Despite the destruction and loss of life, the British did not waver. The RAF, although badly outnumbered, began to hit back hard. Two technological devices helped turn the tide in the Royal Air Force, the British Royal Air Force's favor. One was the electronic tracking system known as radar. Developed in the late 1930s, radar could tell the number, the speed, and the direction of incoming warplanes. The other device was a German code-breaking machine called the Enigma. A copy of the Enigma machine had been smuggled into Great Britain in the late 1930s, and the Enigma enabled the British to decode German secret messages. With that information, the RAF flyers were quickly able to launch attacks on the German enemy very efficiently. To avoid the RAF's attacks, the Germans gave up daylight raids in October of 1940 in favor of night bombings. At sunset, the wail of sirens filled the air as Londoners flocked to the subways, which served as air raid shelters. Some rode out the bombing raids at home in smaller air raid shelters or in their basements. But this Battle of Britain continued until May 10th of 1941. When stunned by the British resistance, Hitler decided to call off his attacks. Instead, he decided to focus on the Mediterranean and on Eastern Europe. The Battle of Britain taught the Allies a really crucial lesson. Hitler's attacks could actually be blocked. It was the first time that Hitler didn't successfully get what he wanted. Here's a quick 90-second rendition of the Battle of Britain.
had successfully invaded much of Europe. His next target was Britain, but he would need air and sea superiority to launch a successful invasion. In early July 1940, the first phase of the German air attack focused on shipping in the Channel. This would draw British planes into the battle and also restrict supplies from reaching the islands. In August, the attack shifted to coastal airfields and radar. However, many of the sites which were hit were quickly put back into action. Phase 3 involved repeated attacks on key British airfields. German intelligence told them the RAF was at breaking point, but to their astonishment, the defence withheld. Hitler grew frustrated and ordered the heavy bombing of British towns to put pressure on Churchill to surrender. The Allies had two main fighter aircraft, the most famous being the Spitfire, but it was the Hurricane which shot down more German planes. The two main German fighters were the Messerschmitt 109 and 110. These have more firepower, but some say a reluctance to push them as hard contributed to their comparative ineffectiveness. One major advantage of the RAF was fighting over home turf. This meant if a pilot was shot down, he could potentially bail out and get straight into another plane. German pilots, on the other hand, would be captured. British planes could also return to base for repairs and refueling more quickly. Germany lost almost 2,700 airmen. Britain lost around 500 airmen. It was Hitler's first defeat, and the last time he threatened British shores.
Next section, the Holocaust. So this particular part of World War II is really difficult to teach virtually. As you guys know, probably from paying attention in the past, that we do a big deal around the Holocaust. We have a Holocaust speaker. We watch a film as a group. Really try to do justice to understanding how it is we get to a point where human beings can watch full-scale groups of people being eliminated without stepping up. So I apologize that this is the way that we're learning this year. Setting the stage. As part of their vision for Europe, the Nazis proposed a new racial order. They proclaimed that the Germanic peoples, or Aryans, were a master race. You guys know a little bit about this from exploring the Lebensborn program. You know that's been going on in the background. So Lebensborn is the development of the master race, and Lebensraum is the living space. So this is the whole idea behind the war, is to create this master race and this space for this new people that are going to rule the world. Using the term Aryans, of course, is a misuse of the term Aryan. The term actually refers to Indo-European peoples who migrated into this Indian subcontinent around 1500 BCE. It's actually where we started the school year. And he had a really racist message. This was a really racist message. He claimed that all non-Aryan peoples, particularly Jewish people, were inferior to anyone who was Aryan. This racist message would eventually lead to the Holocaust, which means offering by fire, which is the systematic mass slaughter of millions of people, Jews and other groups judged inferior by the Nazis. To gain support for his racist ideas, Hitler knowingly tapped into a hatred for Jews that had really deep roots in European history, called anti-Semitism. For generations, many Germans, along with other Europeans, had targeted Jews as the cause of their failures. Some Germans even blamed Jews for their country's defeat in World War I and for its economic problems after the war. Completely misplaced, but we often scapegoat when we're struggling as a people. In time, the Nazis made targeting of Jews a government policy. The Nuremberg Laws, which were passed in 1935, deprived Jews of their rights to German citizenship, forbade marriages between Jews and non-Jews, and laws passed later also limited the kinds of works that Jews could do. It's important that the Nuremberg Laws, one of the earliest steps was to strip them of citizenship, because what some of you might not think about, your citizenship grants you protections. So as a citizen of the United States, the Constitution protects you. And by stripping the Jews of their citizenship, this is Joseph Goebbels delivering speeches that were talking about those Nuremberg laws to the German people. It gave the Jews not a way to fight back against it, not a legal recourse, since they weren't citizens any longer. These same laws prevented Jews from owning particular types of businesses and kept people from going into businesses owned by Jews from that point forward that were still legal. So these are soldiers hanging up posters on the Jewish-owned businesses. Eventually, they would also have to call attention to themselves and wear something that identified them as a Jew. In some places, it was an armband with the Star of David. In some places, people wore patches on the, like over their hearts on the left side of their jackets on the outside. Or there were a number of different ways in which they were identifying themselves. I think it's pretty important to remember the Holocaust also murders millions of people that were not Jews. And the Soviets, communists, Germans that didn't fit the mold, anybody with physical disabilities, anybody who was practiced a different lifestyle, anybody who wasn't part of this perfect master race could become victim of the Holocaust. Kristallnacht translates to Night of Broken Glass, and it occurs in 1938. You should have read a piece of homework about it. Worse was yet to come. Early in November of 1938, a 17-year-old boy, Herschel Grispan, a Jewish youth from Germany, was visiting his uncle in Paris. And while he was there, he received a postcard, and it said that after living in Germany for 27 years, his father had been deported to Poland. On November 7th, wishing to avenge his father's deportation, Herschel shot a German diplomat who was living in Paris. When Nazis heard the news, they launched a violent attack on Jewish communities. On November 9th, Nazi stormtroopers attacked Jewish homes, businesses, and synagogues across Germany and murdered close to 100 Jews. As Americans in Leipzig wrote, Jewish shop windows by the hundreds were systematically smashed. The main streets of the city were positive litter of shattered plate glass. It is for this reason that the night of November 9th became known as Kristallnacht, or Night of Broken Glass. A 14-year-old boy described his memory of that awful night. All the things for which my parents had worked for 18 long years were destroyed in less than 10 minutes. Piles of valuable glasses, expensive furniture, linens, in short, everything, was destroyed. The Nazis left us yelling, "Don't try to leave this house. We'll soon be back again and take you to a concentration camp to be shot." Kristallnacht marked a major step up in the Nazi policy of Jewish persecution. The future for Jews in Germany was beginning to look very grim.
Kristallnacht, or the Night of Broken Glass, was the wave of violent anti-Jewish pogroms on November 9th and 10th of 1938. It took place throughout Germany, annexed Austria, and in areas of Czechoslovakia recently occupied by German troops. Kristallnacht owes its name to the shards of shattered glass from the windows of synagogues, homes, and Jewish-owned businesses that lined German streets in the wake of the pogrom. On November 7, 1938, Ernst von Rauch, a German embassy official stationed in Paris, was assassinated by Herschel Grispan, a 17-year-old Polish Jew living illegally in Paris. Grispan revengefully shot the diplomat after witnessing the expulsion of not only his parents, but thousands of Jews of Polish citizenship living in the German Reich. Von Rauch died on November 9, 1938. The same day, at a meeting of Nazi party leadership, Propaganda Minister Joseph Goebbels, the chief instigator of the Kristallnacht pogroms,